are watching the HTV television programs of California State University Dominguez Hills.
The following DHTV live broadcast is featured as a special presentation of National Distance Learning Week and the United States Distance Learning Association. Questions you might have about your landscape or gardening, landscape maintenance, trees. We talk about everything from apples to zinnias and trees to turf. Now, we like to start our show with some upcoming events in the Southern California area. So let's take a look at some things that you might want to put on your calendar. What do we have first? We have tree trimming guidelines. Very timely, because today we're going to talk about tree trimming. This is a class at the Manhattan Beach Botanical Gardens. It is November 14th from 10 to 11 a.m. It is a free class, but you need to call and let them know that you're coming. Get a reservation because it can't fill up. The number is 310-546-1354. And that should be an excellent one-hour course on how to trim trees. In addition to that, we have the Orchid Festival coming up at the San Diego Botanical Gardens, formerly Quail Botanical Gardens. That is November 21st from 9 to 4 p.m. You can call 760-436-3036 for information regarding entrance fees and plants that will be for sale. You'll be able to learn a lot about growing orchids and purchase some as well. In addition to the Orchid Festival, we have Successful Succulents also at the Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden on November 21st from 10 to 11 a.m. Again, these classes at the Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden are free to the public, but you need a reservation so that they know how many people are going to come and they can accommodate everyone who shows up. So, hopefully you can jot those down on your calendar and participate in some of those events. Now, today, I want to talk about pruning trees. But before I get into the lecture on how to prune trees and pruning guidelines, and that's extremely timely because most of our tree pruning does occur during the winter months. That's the most important or appropriate time to prune most of our trees. So that's coming right up in the next few months. But we have a brand new insect pest in the Western United States and here in Los Angeles County. We just collected it my laboratory. Actually, I'm the plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture. But we also have an entomologist, and so our entomologist collected this new insect pest here in Southern California. He got it in Culver City. And as I was waiting for the show to begin today, I was walking around the grounds here in Cal State, Dominguez Hills, and I noticed some trees just outside the building. And they are Melaleuca quinquinerva, which is one of the Melaleuca species that is commonly grown throughout Southern California. And we have this new pest on Melaleuca quinquinerva. Now, the Melaleucas are often referred to as paper barks because that big, soft, spongy bark peels off in large sheets, almost like paper. And there are a number of species we grow, and quinquinerva has five, it's often called the five-lined Melaleuca. It has other common names as well. It has five veins in the leaf. And what we found was a new solid on this Melaleuca, and it has an interesting story. And of course, when I saw those Melaleucas up there, I walked up to see if they had about it, and they did. It's all over. And it's quite dramatic, so let's take a look at this pest. It broke off a little branch. There it is. And so it's quite small. Now the thing is, we'll go to the overhead cam so you can get a look at the stings and characteristics on this. First thing you're going to notice is there's a lot of white fluffy material on the leaves. And this white fluffy material is a wax that's produced by the nymphs, by the larval stage right here. It's this white fluffy material right here. And so there are, you'll see that. That's the most obvious thing you're going to see. Now, the adults are small and yellow, and they're quite small. And this is them right here. Let's see if I can get one of these leaves. Here you can see one just above my thumbnail. You can see how small they really are. There's one right there. Let me take a leaf and point it out. Here's an adult right there. You can see it's kind of yellowish orange. It has clear wings. Here's another one right there. And then the larvae are actually also all over these leaves. They're much smaller. And they produce all this fluffy, white, waxy material. They also, since they're sucking insects, they can put you. And you'll get this black sooty mold growing on the leaves in the honeydew that drips off of the larva, and also probably off the adults as well. So this is the newest insect pest that we have here in Los Angeles County, and really, I would imagine it'll spread rapidly, and you'll find it on all the point urban, all over Southern California. We've called it in Culver City earlier this week, or I should say Dr. R.K., our entomologist with the Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture, collected it. And he's created a new pest information sheet, and he has quite a few of those pest information sheets that are on the LA County Agriculture Commissioner Weights and Measures Department on our website. And if you're not familiar with me, you can watch the show for I'm the Senior Biologist Plant Pathologist for the Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture. I also am a certified arborist, and I have a California State Pest Control Advisor's License for Agricultural Production. And I've been working in the landscape industry and taking care of ornamentals for a long time. So if you have any questions about that type of subject, that's what this show is all about. So as I was saying, I ran into that pest. Another interesting thing about this cilid that's on the Melaleuca is that Melalucas in Florida are a noxious weed, and they're invasive, and they're coming out all over the Everglades. And so they've got a lot of rules prohibiting growing Melaleucas and prohibiting them in mulch and stuff like that. So that they can try and control Melaleucas here and grow Melaleucas as an ornamental. Well, this cilid was actually introduced in Florida as a biocontrol agent against the Melaleucas to try and control their growth and slow them down, if not eradicate them. And it certainly won't eradicate them, but it might control their growth. And it does cause defoliation, and the trees will defoliate from the infestation. So they introduced in Florida as a biocontrol agent. Now it's here, and it's going to be a pest on our ornamentals. The likelihood of bringing in a biocontrol for the cilid is not good, because we'll probably be prohibited from doing that. Florida wouldn't appreciate us finding out this new pest. If they allow control agent, it's our pest. So we'll see what happens in the future. I see we have an email question. Are there any insects that you can use to combat these new pests? Currently, there is nothing specific. And let me just comment briefly about biocontrol in insects. There are many generalists, things like lacewings and ladybug beetles and praying mantises, things like that. And they eat a lot of insects, but they're not specific to one insect, and they rarely ever will bring insect pests under control, specific pests. The things that work best are the parasitoid wasps, and they're very, very small. They're about the size of a pinhead. But technically, they're wasps. They're in that group. They don't sting people or bite people. What they do is they lay their eggs, usually in the larva of the pest that you're trying to control. And typically what's happened is the pest has come from another part of the world. Often, you know, the examples are from Australia, because we grow some Australian species. This is Melaleuca, and just a whole bunch of plants that grow from Australia. And then, over that, eucalyptus species, or many different eucalyptus species, for decades and decades without any problems, and suddenly we'll find a new insect feeding on the eucalyptus. So what we do is we go back to a scientist, a professor usually at a UC campus, will be working on that group of pests, and they'll go back to Australia, they'll look for parasitoids in Australia, and then bring them back here. They have to rear them, they have to show that they won't eat anything else, that they're really going to be limited to controlling the target pest and not just, you know, attack or feed on a native insect that may not necessarily be an important insect, but we don't want to start disrupting our own insect, our own native flora. So once they show that this is going to be safe, they release it, and those parasitoid wasps usually are very effective at bringing under various insect pests that we've had over the years. We have white fly was controlled that way. The red gum larva is being controlled that way. The giant whitefly is being controlled that way. There's a whole list of them. And it's been very, very successful using these parasitoid wasps. The question is, will we be able to bring in a parasitoid wasp for this particular pest, this new Psyllida melaleuca? And I would guess the answer would be no, because Florida is using it as biophagocytic melaleuca. And so it would be advisable to try and bring in something that would disrupt their biophagocytic program. And the everglades are a critically important area. Really, even if you don't live in Florida, all these areas of the United States, these natural areas, are really important to everyone. So we need to protect them, and that will just be a problem for the everglades. So, unfortunately, if there isn't anything you would be able to rely on, you're probably going to have to rely on either spraying, perhaps with oils and soaps, or using systemic insecticides as a drench on the roots, which would probably be about 12 months control. Now, what I wanted to talk to you today about is pruning your large shade trees or pruning trees in general. We often see terrible pruning practices in Southern California, really misguided from individuals who have not had any coursework in botany or horticulture and don't realize that what they're doing is quite harmful to the trees. There are some very specific reasons we prune trees, and there are some very good guidelines. And if you want to go to that Manhattan Beach Botanical Garden training or course, you'll get even more information. But let's go over the guidelines and why you prune trees. Now, you prune trees for a variety of reasons. And often large trees can represent a hazard. You can have very large limbs, the tree may be leaning, there may be a number of things within the tree that makes it a hazardous tree. And so you can prune the tree to reduce the hazard that that tree may present to you. So you want to remove dead branches. You want to remove any diseased branches as well. Crowded and growing limbs. You want to train for future growth. This is particularly important on young new trees. You want to increase light penetration inside the tree. You can control the size of the tree to some extent, but you really can't make a 75-foot tree a 25-foot tree, especially if it's already 75-foot. So controlling the size is really more appropriate for small trees, or if it's something you do very early in the tree's growth with a new tree. I see we have a phone call, so let's go to our first caller today. Jim calling from Northern Drew on the air. Jim, are you there?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, what's your question today?
My question is, I have what I call a potato tree. It's a cilantro. What is really flush, one of them is completely gone, and the other one is fairly flush. But I don't understand why one of them is completely gone, and the other one is really flush, and the third one, fairly alive, I would say. I don't know.
Okay, how often do you water these trees?
I have a sprinkler system that's on every few days, because that's all I'm allowed to water.
Actually, you're only allowed to water on 2 days a week. You you'll meet him. So it goes on quite soon.
Yes.
And before the restrictions, how often were you watering?
They were watered almost 6 days a week.
Okay, you were drowning them.
I was drowning them?
Yeah. Okay. I have to admit, I'm not familiar with your tree. Is Solandra?
Yes.
You know, that's a new one to me. I don't know that genus offhand. A potato tree. But I don't even know where it's native to. Do you know offhand where it's native to?
No, I really don't know that much about it. Well, I'm slow to put them on both sides of my garage.
Okay. Well, generally, I mean, let me just talk to you about watering your trees. Because if you were watering them 6 days a week, how long did the sprinklers actually run when they went on?
Probably about 5 minutes.
I hate to point the finger at you, but that is the worst way to water.
It is.
Trees, almost all the trees we grow in Southern California, need to be deep watered periodically. So that means about every 2 or 3 weeks, depending on where you live and the species. Some trees you're going to need water once a week, but you're going to need to water them long enough to soak the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet, which is going to take anywhere from an hour to 4 hours, depending on your application rate and your soil. When you water 5 minutes, if you have a typical pop-up sprinkler that people use for lawns, they apply about, on average, they can apply up to 2 inches an hour. So if you're ready for 5 minutes, you can put out less than a 16th of an inch. That's going to wet about a half an inch of soil. And then every day you're going to do that again and again and again, and you're going to keep the upper soil profile soaking wet. That's perfect conditions for root rot. So I suspect that the one that's dying most likely has root rot because you kept it way too wet. And the other is, you know, the thing about root rot is it's really a disease. It's caused, you know, there's a variety of fungi that will cause root rot. The most common is really not a fungus, it's called Phacophthora. It's really a parasitic algae. But it is favored by wet soils. All of them are favored by wet soils. And the number one means of controlling root rot is the frequency of irrigation. You soak the soil deep, and then you let it dry out for 1, 2, 3, 4 weeks. It all depends on the season where you live. You're in Northridge, it's pretty hot. I'm guessing that this is probably one of the most of our big trees are fairly drought tolerant. They only need to be watered about once or twice a month. Certainly in the spring and fall, when we're cool out, once a month is usually sufficient. On some other types of trees, during the summer, you're going to need to go up to every 2 weeks. On some of the trees that are native to areas that get a lot of rainfall, like Magnolia grandiflora, which is native to the southern United States, they get a lot of rain during the summers. They do best when soaked deeply once a week in the summer. But our things like another big tree that we grow, Chinese elm, you soak it once a month, it will do great. If you start watering them every day, so I suspect your problem with your tree is directly related to how you were watering. You still there?
Yeah, go ahead.
So what you need to do, the best way to water your trees is not really a lawn type sprinkler system, but with a soaker hose, or with some way of slowly applying the water over several hours, so you don't get any runoff, and you get a deep soak. So a soaker hose, or if you make a big basin around the tree and fill it up repeatedly on any given day, but then you let it drain and dry for several weeks. Now for your remaining trees that are still fairly healthy, you're going to water them once a month through the winter if we get another rain. And then you also want to broadcast gypsum, which is calcium sulfate, all around the base of the tree and underneath the canopy of the tree. About a quarter inch thick, all underneath on the soil, and scratch that in gently, so it mixes with about a quarter inch of soil. Okay? And then in the spring, about February or so, put down a thick layer of mulch under the canopy of the tree, up to 4 inches, but not up against the trunk. You can leave about a foot or two around the trunk where there's no mulch, but a thick layer of mulch all the way out to the drip line, if you can do that. And that mulch is also all these things by your frequency irrigation, by your the gypsum and the mulch. All of those will help you control any root rot that you have on your trees. Okay?
Yes, thank you very much.
And try that, and call us back and let us know how it works out. Okay?
Very much for your help. Really
okay. Thank you for your call. Okay, we were talking about buying and pruning trees. And most of you want to prune to improve the health of the tree and to enhance its natural form. And you may hear me say that repeatedly, to enhance its natural form, because too many people prune trees and they really have no concept of what the natural form of the tree is. They make it, they pretty much look like a telephone pole, and nothing to do with a fruit tree, and severe pruning and large wounds. So let's go over the general guidelines for pruning trees. Again, prune to enhance its natural form. Avoid large wounds, and anything over 2 inches should be considered a large wound. So when you see people cut the top of a tree off and then leave a 8-inch or a 10-inch or a 12-inch cut right through the top of the tree, obviously that's a major wound, and there's really no justifiable reason for cutting the top of a tree. All several reasons to remove any large scaffold branches or large branches. Do not wound the trunk. We'll go over why this is so important. Never wear spikes in a tree. People, unfortunately, put spikes on and climb a tree and poke holes all up another trunk. That's a disaster for a tree. And down the road, that's going to create so many problems. Do not wound the trunk. Don't wear spikes. Remove branches from the branch beyond the branch collar. We'll take a look at that in a minute. Limit the removal of foliage, green wood, or foliage to no more than 25% of the canopy in a single prune. For some species, it's actually reduced down to 10%, such as oaks. Mature trees that have been well pruned and maintained for many years need only lengthening, and then you're removing about 10% of green wood. Prune when the tree is dormant. Generally, it's always when we want to prune when the tree is dormant. Remove branches to their point of origin, that's always best, rather than tipping or topping. And never severely prune or top trees or defoliate trees. That's the worst thing you can do. I see another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Eileen, you're on the air. What's your question?
I'm calling to vary the looking for status.
Okay.
Why has the tree and the fruit falls off before it gets ripe? And she had a concern with that. Maybe she would start off with maybe 40 pieces of fruit, and as they get larger, they're still green, and they just fall from the tree. She would end up with maybe 10 fruit left on there to ripen.
Do you know how often she waters the tree?
She was told that she was watering it so often, and now I believe it's like once a week she tried to keep watering.
Well, generally if a tree is dropping its fruit, it's because the load, it's got too much of a fruit load, or there's some kind of stress factor on the fruit. So it's not able to mature all the fruit that's on the tree. Fruit trees always drop some fruit, usually when it's small, before it enlarges and gets full size and mature. You see that in avocados, you see it in citrus, and in many, many fruit trees. If you're losing a lot of fruit, like 3/4 or 75-80% of the fruit before it matures, then there's really got to be something stressing the tree. If she's watering, in fact, persimmons once a week, it would be the maximum you would water the tree. They actually can be watered about every 2 weeks during the summer months and once a month in the spring and the fall. So you want to get a soaker hose, and you want to soak them deep. You hear me say it over and over again. Deep water periodically. Now, they shouldn't be ripening right now. They're deciduous, and they're going to drop all their leaves. If it doesn't rain, she can water once a month in the winter. In the spring, she can continue to water once a month until later in the spring, about June, she can start watering every 2 weeks. Do you know if she fertilizes?
Probably a year before or something.
Okay, well, she should fertilize up to 3 times a year. And she should use a low nitrogen fertilizer. Either a fruit tree, I would use Miracle-Gro. of view, I would use fruit tree fertilizer, either a synthesis avocado food, or I would use cottonseed meal. And if you want to up the nitrogen just a little bit, you can mix cottonseed meal and blood meal. Add 4 parts cottonseed meal with 1 part blood meal. Now, cottonseed meal is about 7% nitrogen. It is non-soluble, and it takes about 6 to 8 weeks for it to break down and be available to the tree. So you get a slow, continuous feed of nitrogen to the tree. And you put that down first right around March, and then you're going to reapply it about June or July, and then you're going to fertilize again in the fall. If she hasn't fertilized this year, she should put some down now, just a little bit. Always use a little less than the label. Using a half feed, you'll get about 80% of the benefit. So deep watering every 2 to 4 weeks, depending on the season, and fertilizing. And that should help quite a bit in drying the fruit.
Okay. There's one more question. On the fruit that remained on the tree, she's having problems with ants. Ants getting into the fruit and up under the little...
Probably under the sepals. She probably has... If you have, it's a small black Argentina, I'm guessing, right? The small black ants.
Oh, the ants, yeah, the little black ones.
The little black ones. Those are Argentine ants. Argentine ants collect honeydew from some insects in the tree. So the ants themselves are not really a pest of the tree itself, although they do disrupt biocontrol. Anything that comes and tries to eat the insects that they're feeding on honey, they'll attack them and protect their cows, basically. So now it's a little late now, but in the spring, when the tree starts to flush out new growth, she should spray with an oil or a soap or a combination of oil and soap, and that will control the sucking insects. And if you control the sucking insects, then the ants won't have any purpose to come up in the tree. They'll keep coming up and trying to reestablish things like white flies or aphids or other types of sucking insects because they feed on the honeydew. They like sugary substances. That's all protein. But right now, she can pick those fruit and just wash them off. The ants themselves won't sting or bite people. They're really harmless to us. They're pests. They come in the house. They're looking for sugars. They're looking for protein and water. Those are the things they really want. And that's why they come into our kitchens and into all of our countertops. And if you leave any meat out overnight, or if you leave a Coke can out, or something, they'll be swarming in by morning. But they also go into the tree for the same reason. They want the sugars that the sucking insects are serving, especially aphids, white flies, and mealybug. Yeah, they're fluffy and white. That could be mealybug or it could be white fly. Most likely mealybug. The mealybugs, if you see the adults, they often have long white tails on them. There are a number of species of mealybugs, but they're all controlled basically the same way, with oils and soaps, very effective. I would stay away from the broad spectrum insecticides because they usually create more problems than they solve. There is always some biocontrol element at play. There will be other insects eating the mealybugs and eating aphids. And when you come in with the harsh chemicals such as malathion or 7 or other chemicals of that nature, you kill everything. And then you end up with a more severe pest problem a few weeks later, because now you've eliminated all your beneficial insects. The oils and soaps have much less of an impact on the beneficials. So there's bulb oil, there's sunspray ultrafine, there's neem oil, there's some other oils that are very effective. And they work really well, especially in the spring. You have to be careful with the oils, not to spray when it's over 90 degrees, because they can burn the foliage on hot temperatures. The other thing is to use soaps. You can use dishwashing soap, or you can purchase safer insecticidal soap. Excuse me. And the best time to do that is starting in the spring when you get the new growth.
Okay, so you spray the trees when it first starts putting out leaves.
That's right.
And then when they have a fruit, continue to spray it.
Well, you want to spray in the spring. You want to spray once a week for about 2 weeks in the spring, and then monitor the tree. It'll take about a month or two for the pests to start coming back. And when you see the pests starting to reappear, then you will need to spray once a week for 3 weeks again. Okay.
Very good.
Good luck with your garden. Thank you for your call. We have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Terry, calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yes. My daughter has a California proposed live oak, and I wanted to know when is the best time to prune it, and how should I prune it?
Well, coastal live oaks are one of our most cherished trees in California, and particularly in Southern California. They're very large trees, some get to even up to 75 feet, most of them get to about 50 feet, 40 to 50 feet. They are summer dormant. That means in a natural setting, they go dormant during the dry season, during the summer. So the best time to prune them is while they're dormant. Usually I don't recommend pruning as early as July or August. So typically September, October, November, and into December are your best months to prune California coastline oak. You don't want to remove more than about 10% of the green foliage in a single pruning. This is a species where most people recommend that you reduce that limit on how much you remove. In general, it's 25% of the foliage. But for oaks, a lot of people reduce that to about 10%. You can remove dead branches and dead wood throughout the year. But if you're starting to prune thin the tree, then you want to limit the removal of the green wood to about 10%. Of course, follow all the other guidelines. Prune to enhance its natural form. Avoid any wounds over 2 inches, if possible. You need a real good reason to remove a large scaffold or branch. It's best to remove branches to the point of origin rather than tip them or what's called drop crotch pruning, where you prune a branch back to a side branch. That may be appropriate. There's the scientific part of pruning, and then there's the artistic part of pruning. And the artistic part is the decision: do I remove a branch entirely, or do I just shorten it? If I have two branches that are doing the same job, which one do I save, which one do I remove? But you want to just thin the tree generally and prune it right about now in December, and that'll be good. The later in the winter you get, if you prune in January or February, we're getting too close to when the tree is going to flush new growth. It's going to flush new growth in about February, and if you prune them right before that flush, they're going to flush even harder because the first response to pruning is rapid new growth. So to minimize that response, we prune trees when they're dormant. And the California coastal live oak and any of our native oaks are really dormant during the summer months when there is no rain and they go dry and they're drought dormant. So thin and prune them.
Okay. Okay, well, thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you for your call.
Okay.
That was a timely phone call on oaks. Now, I do want to kind of emphasize that last point I made to our last call. And you have to remember this, the first response to pruning is rapid new growth. So we want to minimize that response. And that's why we will remove 25% of the canopy or less. And that's why when you prune trees when they're dormant, if you prune trees when they're just about to flush in the spring, or if you prune trees when they're really actively growing, then you enhance that natural response. They grow like crazy. So that is, you don't want to encourage that response. You want to minimize it. And now we're going to take a look at the branch column before we do that. Let's take our next call. Yola, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Hi.
What's your question today?
I have a question about passion flower, the passion flower fruit. I have the tree for about 5 years, and I've only seen fruit on it once, and when I saw it, it looked like it was dry and withered up. When is the fruit there, and what am I doing wrong?
Passion vine is a really beautiful flower, but the ones we typically grow are not the ones people use for fruit. is not very fleshy. It's not real good edible fruit. I mean, you can eat it. It tastes fine, but it's not as appealing as the one we grow for fruit. So they will appear a little dry. Now, typically, they'll bloom in the spring, and you'll get the fruit during the summer months. Now, if you want to get more fruit, do you fertilize your vine?
Basically, I would do putting as they grow around the base of them.
Okay, I would use a fruit tree type fertilizer because you want to encourage flowering and fruit production. You want a low nitrogen fertilizer that's higher in potassium and phosphorus. And if you're not familiar with the numbers on a fertilizer bag, on every fertilizer bag, there's three numbers usually on the very front. And it stands for nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, NPK. High nitrogen fertilizers stimulate lots of growth, and we use high nitrogen fertilizers on things like lawns just to green them up. So that'd be like a 30-10-10. Fruit tree fertilizers are often more like 10-15-15 or even a 5-10-10, something like that. And that's what you want to use on your vine. How often do you water it?
Maybe like once a week.
Okay, once a week is good. They are kind of a higher water plant material than a lot of other. They're not really drought tolerant in that they can go for 2 to 4 weeks without irrigation. You want to deep soak them. How long do you water them for?
Just basically trying to soak the base of the four areas. They have it around a gazebo, so the four areas are just soaked there.
With a hose or with an automated system?
With a hose.
Okay, how long do you stand there with your hose?
Not
long. Most people don't have the patience to stand there and soak them deep. Okay, so if you have a basin around them, you could fill that basin up like 3 times in a day. And that would be your irrigation for that week. If you don't have a basin, I would use a soaker hose and I would turn it on for about 30 minutes up to an hour.
Okay.
If you stand there with a hose and just kind of spray the soil, I don't think you're putting down enough water to deep soak them.
Okay.
You'd have to stand there for about 15 to 30 minutes to water each one of them. So that takes a long time. So soaker hoses are great. You turn them on for 30 minutes or maybe an hour. And then if you want to test how deep that water has gone, you can take some type of metal rod, like a concrete reinforcing rod or any kind of rod, and shove it into the ground. It will go roughly as deep as the water went, and it's dry soil. It'll be much more difficult to push it. It'll stop.
Okay.
And that'll give you an idea. You know, if you turn it on for a half hour and you push that rod and it goes down 12 inches, that's not really quite deep enough. You want to maybe run it another 15 minutes so you can get that rod down about 18 inches or even 24 inches.
Okay.
So deep water, and then fertilize up to 3 times a year, spring, summer, and fall, with a low nitrogen fertilizer.
Thank you so much.
Okay, try that out and let us know how that works out for you. Thank you for your call. We have another call. Let's go to our next caller. Paula, calling from Encino, you're on the air. Paula, are you there?
Hi.
Hi. What's your question today?
My question is, I want to raise flower bulbs. I don't want to force them, and I want to put them in containers, and I want them to be good, healthy bulbs when they finish blooming. But my question is, how much root
space
do they need? They always tell me I need to plant them, but then how much more soil do they have to need underneath them?
What, any particular bulbs? Daffodils?
Well, I have
a pretty growth. I'm sorry, is it daffodils?
Daffodils and narcissus.
And narcissus, okay.
Right.
Generally, you know, most people grow those in about an 8-inch pot, maybe a 10-inch pot. Standard, you know, an 8 to 10-inch pot is usually okay. And then you want to, a lot of people like to put a little bone meal in the bottom, about an inch below the bulb. Bone meal is really good for bulbs.
Yeah, I've read that.
And this is the time of year to put them in. And they'll bloom in the spring for you. In pots, they tend to bloom a little earlier than in the ground. Maybe because they warm up a little more in the pot than they do in the soil.
Okay.
You want to have those out in the full sun. Or they, you know, in pots, you have to water them more than you water anything in the soil. Pots dry out rapidly.
Right. Right.
So you're going to have to water those about once. Well, if it's real cold, if we have a cool, you know, winter, once a week, and then as we warm up about twice a week, and then keep watering them all through the spring, and then as the foliage starts to wither about June or so, then you can either tie those in a little loop, or you can just cut them off, and then shake them off, store them in a cool, dry location, usually in a paper bag. Of course, they're an excellent bulb in the soil because they typically repeat bloom quite well, and you can naturalize with them. I get a little bone meal to add with it, and some cottonseed meal as well.
Now, the question is, how much soil do they need underneath the bulb for the root growth?
Oh, probably, I'm almost guessing, I would say about 2 to 4 inches.
Okay.
Yeah, if you're using a potting mix, I would use a potting mix, and not, you got to make sure you use a potting mix.
Oh, really?
Not soil right out of your garden.
Oh.
Okay. Well, pots are different than growing in the ground. When you put natural soils in pots, they tend to cake and pull away from the edge of the pot.
Okay.
And then when you water, it just goes right along the edge and it doesn't wet the soil properly.
Oh, yeah. Is there a potting mix to recommend?
I would get a more expensive potting mix. Bandini makes it, Scott makes it, Kellogg makes it. All those should be fine.
Okay.
Be careful if you open up the bag and get a cheap one. What I've seen is, especially on these generic potting mixes, is there's too much wood chip in it. There's too much undecomposed wood. And that often causes problems because then as you get it wet and you start watering it, the bacteria and fungi start decomposing it and lock up all the nitrogen.
I'd like to see that on that. That's what happens.
Yeah, but if you get like Bandini or Scott's or Kellogg or any like quality potting mix, it's going to cost more money. It doesn't have all that wood chip. Wood chip is great for the soil. You have to be careful not to lock up all the nitrogen. This is a problem with putting raw wood products directly in the soil. For about 2 weeks, you have an induced nitrogen deficiency. Because as that organic matter, as that wood decomposes, there's a fungal and a bacterial bloom in the soil. It'll happen in a pot, too. So use a good potting soil and then fertilize them monthly, lightly. And I also would add bone meal. And some people also, when they plant them in the soil, they also put a little sulfur down a couple inches below that as well.
Sulfur underneath? Yeah, below the tail?
Yeah, about 2 inches below the bulb.
Okay.
So it's not directly in contact. I believe that's to acidify the soil. It's just pure mineral sulfur. It's just a yellow powder.
Okay.
And when if you decide to purchase a bag of that and use it, be careful with it. If you get it on your clothes, it'll stain your clothes brown. And when you open the bag, it's extremely powdery. And it kind of fluffs up in the air, and you'll taste it right away. It probably won't hurt you any, but you can use iron sulfate or you can use your sulfur.
Okay, I appreciate that.
Okay.
I understand all that.
Okay, good luck with your bulbs. And that's where you find the grow in pots. Then you can bring them inside. I have a clip that I made with a colleague of mine at the Arboretum with Frank McDonough. On circle roots. So I want to go to the circle root clip now, and then we'll go back to tree pruning. Let's go to our circle root clip video. Hello, my name is Jerry Turney. I'm the host and instructor for Gardens of California. I'm also a plant pathologist and an arborist. And today we're here to look at one of the common problems that trees have in landscapes, and that's circle roots. Now we're going to look at some western herbivores, Platanus rhizomatosum. They're native to the western United States and a very popular landscape tree. But what happened in this instance is we are looking at some trees where the owners called up the Los Angeles County Arboretum because one of the trees was doing very poorly. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at these three trees. They were all planted at the same time. The one that is badly stunted and extremely stressed, it didn't decline. So when I first walked up to the sycamore, I noticed that it was stunted and it was doing very poorly, especially in comparison to the other two trees on either side of it. And they were all planted at the same time. So clearly there was something wrong with this tree. But when I walked up and looked down at the base of it, it was really quite obvious what was wrong with it. This tree has circle roots. Circle roots occur in the reproduction of the tree because the trees live too long in their pots. As they don't pop with their roots, they start to grow in a circle around the edge of the pot. Then they move up to another pot size, and they live too long in that pot, they'll make circle roots in that pot as well. So the real key to controlling this is in nerve reproduction and moving the trees up from one pot size to the next pot size in a timely fashion. That usually means within about 6 months being in one single pot. So we look down here, right here, you see the circle root circling around the trunk of the tree. In fact, there's circle roots all around the trunk of this tree. The tree is badly stunted. It's very stressed, and you can tell by looking at the tree that it is stressed. We'll look at some of its companion trees right next to us here in a second. But you'll notice this rough bark in here. This tree is heavily infested with the sycamore wood borer, whereas its companions really have almost no sycamore wood borer at all. The sycamore wood borer is common on western sycamore. But in this case, you can see that the stress has made this tree much more susceptible to this insect pest. So if you look at the base of this western sycamore, you'll see that it has excellent root flare. That means the roots flare out and go into the soil off the base of the tree. This is how trees should be if they've been planted correctly and if they don't have circle roots. We saw on the other tree that it had bad circle roots, that it's stunted the tree, it's badly damaged. This tree has excellent root flare. Excellent help.
So that was an interesting little clip that Frank and I made. Frank edited that. We spent a little time looking at that tree. Circle roots are a serious problem on trees. And if you are out buying a tree, really what you want to get is a small tree in a big pot. There's a lot of discussion in the landscape industry and the landscape community about how best to produce large landscape trees in commercial production. What size pot to use, how long to leave them in a pot, how often should they be moved up. That general rule of thumb, about 6 months, up for about a year, especially in a 1 gallon pot, in about 6 months. Then you move it up to a 5, you move it up to a 15, and then they usually get better to move it up to a 44 inch box. If you leave them in the pot for a couple years, then it's too long. So let's talk about some of the things that we want to avoid. And this is the branch, bark ridge, or the branch collar. Now, this is important because this is the branch, and this right here is trunk wood. Everything on this side is trunk wood, and this is branch wood. And if you're going to remove this branch, if this is a dead branch, you want to remove it, you don't want to prune like this. That was kind of the old way of pruning. It's just cutting right along the edge of the trunk. And this leaves a very large wound, and it actually wounds the trunk. And the reason that's bad is because you're going to open up the trunk to decay. And so you want to avoid the large wound, and you want to do not open up the trunk to decay. So instead, the cut is here. Now, the other thing to be careful of is disturbing. So if you just start cutting here and you end about here, this branch is going to do this. And then it's going to hit here and tear down the side of the trunk. So if we go to our next image, the number 5, it shows a very similar situation. Well, we'll just go ahead and take a look at this photograph. This is a Whitaker. And here you can see on this tree, right here, is a spine at the base of the branch. So if you want to remove this branch for some reason, for blocking the sign, if it had broken in the wind, if it had a decayed pocket and you were afraid it was going to break, for whatever valid reason you had to remove this branch, you would want to first make a small cut right here, and then you're going to cut it, let's make that small cut up here. Then we're going to cut here, and as you're cutting, if it starts to hinge, it'll just come off. Then you're going to be left with a big nub. You're going to be left with a nub about that big. Okay? Then you're going to come back and you're going to cut it just about an inch outside of the branch collar. And this whole area here is the branch collar. That way you avoid hitting and ripping the bark on the trunk, and you avoid wounding the trunk entirely. Now, so why is it so important not to wound the trunk? Because every time you wound the trunk, you open it up to decay. Trees have the natural ability to compartmentalize decay within the trunk, and old trees are often hollow. They have heart rot. And trees compartmentalize that decay. And they make walls inside the trunk. And these walls, they make them by depositing things like lignins and gums and other things that the tree manufactures that inhibit the decay of the wood. So when you have a big trunk, in the middle maybe you rot it, there's actually an area around that rot that's preventing the rot from extending farther out into the tree. And every time you wound the trunk, you defeat the tree's ability to compartmentalize and limit the decay. So you never wound the trunk of a tree. It's the worst wound that a tree can get, especially ripped bark. That's actually the worst. Now if we go to the next picture, there's another point to make, and that's number 7. It's also a liquid hipper. And bring this up full size, and I'll show you some things on this picture. You can see here where a number of branches have either been removed or fell off naturally. And what you see here is that they're all closed up and sealed. And that process of callus tissue formation, which grows in and seals the wound, you want that to go as quickly as possible. And by having a smaller wound, it seals up much faster. So this tree has been pruned quite nicely in that you don't have these large wounds right up against the front, and you've got smaller wounds that have sealed and healed. There's two different kinds of pruning, ways to prune. And if we take a look at number 8, there are heading cuts and there are thinning cuts. Heading is when you cut the end off a branch, and thinning is when you remove the whole branch. So we'll take a quick look at this cartoon. It's number 8. Heading and thinning cuts. And you can see what we're talking about in terms of removing just the tip of a branch or removing the whole branch. Well, perhaps that slide's not available. The other thing to remember, okay, here we go, this is good. Now, if we bring this up full screen, you can see if you cut right here, that's topping, okay? And these are topping cuts. Here's a topping cut right there, and here's a topping cut right there. This is either a heading cut or a topping cut where you top the tree. And of course, the reason they're doing this in this diagram is because of the telephone lines and power lines. Now, remember, when you dip like this, the first response is going to be rapid new growth. And if we can bring up the tipping diagram, you'll see that in the branch, there are many dormant buds. And when you remove the end of the branch, all those dormant buds then are free to take off. And if we take this up full screen, you can see on these cut-ins right here that all these branches start growing very rapidly. The first response to pruning is rapid new growth. And the reason is that this is a top tier. You can see right here, all these topping cuts. And if you drive around now, you see this all the time. People come in, cut the top of all the branches off, defoliate the tree, and they don't know if it's dormant. And then the whole tree breaks with growth right at those pruning wounds. The problem with this is that when a tree is young and it starts to grow, and you've got a trunk and you've got a branch growing on that trunk, the trunk grows and then the branch grows, and the trunk grows and the branch grows. And years later, you've got a big trunk and a big branch. That branch goes to the middle of the trunk. It is secure to the center of the tree. When you whack off the end of a branch, or you whack off the top of a tree, and all the buds are growing on the edge of the trunk, those branches are only attached to the very edge of the tree itself, and they tend to rip and fall off easily. They grow very, very fast. They act like separate individual trees within the canopy, and you lose the natural control of growth. Trees control their growth by apical dominance. The top of the tree controls the growth of the whole tree. So when you cut off the top, the whole tree just breaks with growth. And we look at picture 10A, and this is a jacaranda. And jacarandas have a tendency to do this anyway. And you can really see what's going on here. This is the top frame. That's a big, very large wound. And what happened was all these branches took off and started growing. And look at this old bark in here. See this old bark? It's furrowed and it's old. And look at this young bark. This means that these branches, this branch here and this branch here, these are very young, fast-growing branches. And if you notice, they're competing with each other. They're growing very, very rapidly. They'll often grow 10 feet or longer before they branch themselves. And they're only attached at the very edge of the trunk, right there and right there. Now, in a wind, this can rip away and tear, and then tear the bark, which is the worst possible damage that you can do to a trunk. If we look at 10B, this also shows another problem that we can get in trees, and this is called a narrow crotch. You can see that this branch here is has actually no crotch. There's no space between it and this. So this can actually be corrected when the tree is young and first planted. But this, that there's no connection between these two branches, and so this branch can tear and pull away quite easily. Now, so why does topping hurt the trees? Well, when you defoliate a tree, when you, you know, again, you don't want to remove about 25% of the canopy. If you top a tree, you basically defoliate it, you take off all of the foliage. This is severely stressing the tree. All the food that the tree gets, it gets from the trees. So it causes severe stress. It opens up the trunk to decay. The new branches are poorly attached. You are going to reduce the lifespan of the tree significantly because you end up with decay. Often the tree is becomes very hazardous because these new branches can fall off fairly easily. It is more susceptible to disease and to insect attack after topping. As people will realize that you might have root rot, or you might have some other disease in the tree that's not evident. And you top the tree, you stress it, and the tree just dies. So, any disease the tree has is made more serious and worse by severe pruning. And really, it makes the tree incredibly ugly. It doesn't look like a tree anymore. Now it looks like a telephone pole. So, why don't you just find a telephone pole? And of course, it does kill trees, especially certain trees that are very, very sensitive to severe pruning, such as pines. If you defoliate a pine, often it will not reflush, it will, or it'll just flush on the trunk. You get all this growth right directly on the trunk, which we call epicormic growth, a clear sign of stress in the tree. And then it'll grow that and then die. So, certain trees are just not a good tree to whack. Other trees are tolerant to severe pruning, and this is good for it. Now, we have some of my gallery of horror. We'll take a look at picture number 13. And this is a lemon scented gum, Eucalyptus sylviadora. And why anyone would do this to a lemon scented gum is beyond me. They require very little to no pruning. In this picture, you'll see that it's severely pruned. Number 13. It basically looks more like a telephone pole than anything else. Let's take a quick look at number 13. And the picture that's up right now is hopefully number oh, I don't know what picture that is. The 13 is a eucalyptus tree. If we can get any of 13 or 14 up, then we can take a look at that. We'll take a look at some of the common mistakes that people make when they're pruning their trees. Okay. Okay. So, if we can bring up any pictures, we'll show some of the severe problems that people do with EB17 and ARB. Here we go. This is great. Let's bring out a full size. This is a eucalyptus, I mean a magnolia grandiflora. This is an evergreen tree that has been butchered. That not one guideline has been followed. You see these very large fruiting woods. This one here. All these areas where they just whacked them. They've removed 99% of the foliage. Now, if you do this in the winter, you may not fry the bark in the full sun, but if you do this in the summer, the sun will come in and fry the bark, especially on the south and west side. And that will just decimate the tree. The bark of trees is meant to be in the shade. The leaves are supposed to be in the full sun. That's the other problem you can get when you defoliate a tree with severe burning. Totally destroys the tree. This is another one, another magnolia grandiflora that was also pruned in the exact same manner. Extremely detrimental to the tree, and will reduce the longevity of the tree significantly. Let's go to our next picture. This tree was killed by the severe pruning that occurred to it. This is probably a ficus tree, although it's hard to tell after it's been killed. But you can see that all the bark is gone. This tree's probably been dead for a long time. This tree was severely pruned. I don't see a foliage grew on it. It probably killed it immediately to prune it like this. So let's go to our next photo. Okay, here is a terrible example of pruning. No one in any of these examples is pruned for the natural form of the tree. But in this case, they not only really butchered the tree with these very large pruning cuts that are going to lead to severe heart rot and a lot of decay. But they left the tree completely asymmetrical. So what happened to the part of the tree that was over here? I mean, they left this big part, but they took away everything else. It's hard to fathom what someone would prune a tree in this fashion. So let's take a look at our next picture. Again, severe pruning. Now in this case, let's go full size on this. These are erythrina coralloids. They are the coral trees. They are rapid growing trees. And they have very soft wood. And they tend to drop their large limbs and rip bark all the time. People tend to come in and do this to them all the time. They prune them back and defoliate them heavily. And actually, again, nothing can be worse for them. Now they're going to develop new growth all over their trunks, and that new growth will tend to rip and tear. Let's take a look at our next photo in sequence. This is a liquid amber. You can see it's been topped right here, and all the branches have been shortened. I hesitate to call this drop by burning because you can see in some instances it really isn't. If you don't want a big tree, then you should remove it and plant a small tree. The liquid ambers get to about 75 feet. And if you want a 25-foot tree, you don't grow a 75-foot tree. This is the worst thing you can do with a liquid amber. Let's take a look at our next photo in succession. This is an olive tree, and this olive tree has been pruned so that nearly 90% of the foliage or more is gone. Generally, olives are very tough and will survive this type of pruning, but very, very rapidly you're going to get growth all along the trunks, anywhere where the sun is. You're going to get growth, and then it's going to look kind of funny. If there's anything wrong with this tree, very likely it can die. And I've often seen with this done in the summer, the sun then comes in and burns any exposed bark on the south and west side. Another horrible example of pruning. Let's go to our next photo in succession. Now this is a magnolia grandiflora, and this is a common mistake. First of all, it's been horribly overfed. It hasn't been topped, but what they've done is strip all the foliage along the entire length of the branch and leave a clump at the end. This is called lion deer. And they've done it on every branch. There's no foliage, and then there's lots of foliage. They even cut the end off here, too. So a couple of things are going to happen with the lion tail. You're going to get shoots growing straight up off of all these branches, straight up in the air. We call those water sprouts. Now, trees have a natural tendency to produce water sprouts. And when you lion tail, when you strip all the foliage off a branch and you have a clump at the end, you encourage these water sprouts. And water sprouts tend to grow up into the canopy and disrupt the natural form. Water sprouts are like an individual tree within the canopy, and they don't respond to apical dominance. So you lose the ability for the tree to control its own growth form. And you have to come back and remove those. You have to remove them fairly rapidly, within about a year. So this type of pruning results in the sun coming down and hitting the top of the branch during the summer, burning the bark, and the production of water sprouts. Plus, what will happen is the growth extends on the end of the branch. You get weight displacement to the end, and it can cause the branch to blow and bend. So it's another poor pruning practice that should be avoided. Leave some foliage in the interior of the branches to shade it and to discourage the water sprouts. Now let's take a look at our next picture in succession. And here we have a tree. Now take a quick look at this. Let's bring this up. We're talking about some trees that were severely pruned. These eucalyptus, probably eucalyptus globulus, the blue gum. And look at this. This is solid growth right on the trunk of the tree. Now, all those shoots are going to compete with each other and try and outgrow each other. It was topped off right here, and it caused the whole tree to just break with growth. This one, the same thing, was topped, and the whole thing was just trying to grow everywhere. All of them were done this way. And so when you see that, you know that you've severely stressed the tree, and that it's really a disaster. And let's take a look at our next photo in succession. Again, this is a Canary Island pine, and this is called epicormic growth all along here. This tree, I know this tree is under a lot of stress, but because it's growing foliage directly on the trunk, that's not how trees should grow their foliage. That indicates severe stress in the tree. And we have holes at the top of this tree, but I know that it was severely pruned. Let's take a look at our next photo in succession. Now, here is a very nice tree. It only has one little problem. It has not been topped. It has a nice central ear right like this. But it does have this branch here, this one right here. It comes up like this. And what you're going to develop here is a narrow cross right in here, or you're going to develop co-dominant leaders. Generally, you want one leader going up the tree, right like this, with the branches coming off like this. Okay? We don't want a leader here, and a leader here, and a narrow cross right there. So what happens? In order to correct this, this is what we would refer to as a structural fault, or a narrow cross. And so to control that, what you do is you go to this branch, and you take off maybe anywhere from 1 to 3 feet off the end of the branch, and you prune back to a side branch that's one-third the size of the branch you're pruning. So if you're pruning a 3-inch branch, you prune back to a 1-inch branch that's one-third the size of the branch you're pruning. That's called drop-crotch pruning. That's how you shorten a scaffold or a major branch. The other option is to remove that branch all the way back to the trunk, to its point of origin. It's actually usually preferable to remove a branch back to its point of origin, but you can't always do that. And especially if by removing the branch, the tree becomes asymmetrical, you're removing a large portion of the canopy, and then most of the foliage is going to be on one side. So you don't want to remove large branches if it leaves your tree asymmetrical. And you can dwarf the branch, you can shorten it, and then you can keep coming back and controlling the growth of that single branch, and allowing the central leader to dominate the tree. And it's still whatever. It looks like what a tree should look like, with a nice central leader and scaffolds distributed evenly vertically along the trunk and horizontally also distributed that way. Now let's look at our next picture in succession. let's bring these up full size. These are also liquid ambers. And liquid amber, of course, is very popular tree in Southern California. And they're deciduous, and this is what they look like in the winter. And it's always good to take a look at trees in the winter. This is where you want to prune this tree, because it is a winter dormant. And take a look right here. Right there is a narrow crotch. Where you have the tree comes up like this, and then it divides into two major trunks or scaffolds. When this tree was very young, this could have been corrected. Now, you need to come up here and maybe prune it here. Let me just use a little arrow. Prune it there. And thin this branch out and try and control the growth of this branch here. And let this one here be the dominant central leader. If you look at the one next to it, it's much better because it has a nice central leader going straight up. These trees haven't been long. Think about that when you comp these trees in the winter, you're going to see all those pruning cuts. You're going to see all those wounds. They're deciduous trees. Once they lose their foliage, you're going to see what you've done. So this is an example of trees that have been well maintained, not topped, healthy, vigorous trees that have not become hazardous. Let's take a look at our next photo session. Oh, this is a great one. Now, many species are very tolerant of severe pruning. And this one is being, I think this is a Ficus, probably Marcus Denida or Ficus benjamina. And I just get a kick out of this, seeing this type of pruning. Really, you can do anything you want with the trees. This tree really isn't hazardous because there's nothing to fall on anybody. And it's kind of whimsical. I don't know what the goal is other than to have a big ball in your yard. But that's. You know, that's, I call this topiary. They want this to look like a lollipop. But certainly this isn't normally what you do to a tree. This was done to this tree after it had been growing in the landscape for many years. It's severely pruned, it floods a lot of growth, and then it is sheared into a ball. You can grow a lot of trees into shapes, that's called topiary. So you can make it look like a dinosaur, you go to Disneyland, you see, you know, the dinosaurs, or there are different various cartoon characters. And some trees are very amenable to that, especially ficus. Ficus do that quite well. Eugenia does that quite well. They're vigorous growers, and they're tolerant of severe pruning. We also use those same species to grow hedges. Many of the hedges we grow are actually full-size trees that are sheared every month into a block or a wall. And we use it for screening and to delineate a space within the landscape. And certain trees will tolerate that, others you really can't do that at all. Now let's take a look at our next photo in succession. And this one's really hilarious. In this case, somebody came in to this. This is a California, this is a Mexican fan home. And of course, they grow quite tall. This one's another one, probably only 10, 15 years old at most. But they remove all the branches, all the leaves right here. And they left this ring of branches, and of course now it's going to take off. I always wonder what people think when they use certain things. It's a joke, but I had a picture of it when I drove by. Now I'll tell you something about pruning palms. When you prune palms, generally remove only the dead fronds, because if you remove all the green fronds and just leave a little puff at the top, the tree won't have enough energy to make a full-size trunk. And so often you'll come and you'll see palms that were pruned like this one was. And the trunk, or the meristem where it's growing and producing the trunk, is starved at this point. And so you come back years later, the trunk goes like this, and then it narrows real small, and then it goes back to normal. And that narrowing, that constriction in the trunk occurred when you severely pruned the palm. So it's not good for palms to severely prune them. We talk usually about when we prune palms, we talk about pruning like a clock. So you prune at about between 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock. You move everything below that. You don't prune above that. You could prune about 3 o'clock and what's on the other side, 9 o'clock. But generally below that, just the dead fronds, leave all the green fronds, and maybe you have to go ahead and prune a little more often. because those dead frogs can fall and they can be a little hazardous, especially in high winds. But you see these pineapple cuts where they come up and remove all the green fronds and they pop at the top. That's very detrimental to palms. And some palms, such as the Canary Island palm, the Phoenix canariensis, often will be frog rot also, because as you're cutting into the frond itself, that green frond, you'll get infected with a frog rot fungus. And usually that fungus is a specific fungus, it's called Phalaenopsis, that often gets into the fronts of these Canary Island palms. It's because of pruning practices. They should be using a flat bladed saw, they should clean that saw between trees, and they should not be removing the green fronds. Let's take a look at our next picture of success. Now, I was talking about the most important time to prune trees. Now we're talking about mature trees. That important time is seasonal. But if you talk about the life of a tree, the most important time to prune a tree is when you plant it, because you can correct structural faults in young trees with a pair of hand shears or a small handsaw. Whereas if you don't do that, and you come back in 20 or 30 years, you may not be able to correct that structural fault at all, or if you do, you have to do it with a chainsaw and you leave very large wounds. So let's bring this picture up full screen and I'll talk about what's really good for trees. There's a number of things to see in this photograph. One is these branches that are on the trunk right here, and here, and here, and here. These branches are very important branches for the first year or two of this tree's life. Now they're too low for the tree when it matures. So should you cut them off right when you plant it, or should you leave them on and take them off later? The answer is leave them on and take it off later. What you do is you just take off the ends of these branches like this. You just tip them. You might tip it here. Now these weren't tipped, and they should have been tipped. And what this does is it dwarfs the branch. But it leaves the branch there to produce foliage. Now, the food that's made in this branch feeds the trunk and accelerates the growth of the trunk, the caliper expansion of the trunk. And it shades the trunk. So it's doing two very important things. It's feeding the trunk and it's shading the trunk. If you remove these things when you plant it and wet them all off like this, the trunk actually will not expand as quickly in a diameter. The caliper will not expand. Plus, on the south and west sides, the cell comes in right there, and it'll burn. So you have to wait until the canopy gets a little bigger for the trees established, starts to grow a canopy, and you can shade the trunk itself. But you don't want these trunks, these branches to grow totally on their own and get really big, because when you come and you let it grow like this, they really should have been dead. You let it just take off. They get pretty big. When you come back in about 12 months to 24 months and prune this off, and then prune beyond the branch column, you cut it right there. If you dwarf them, you have a smaller wound. So by tipping them, you have a smaller wound when you eventually remove them. The other thing you see here is the proper way to stake a tree. You put a large stake on either side, and then you take a flexible material and you wrap it in a finger ring, kind of like this, around, and that allows the tree to move in the wind. It can move back and forth like this in the wind, and that actually strengthens the trunk of the tree, because the movement in the wind encourages the tree or reduces the tree to strengthen the trunk. The one thing that's not necessary is this lower tie. You don't need it. Put that little bit of that lower tie is not necessary. Only this one up here. These things should only be left on the tree for about 12 months. Once the tree can hold itself up, it should be removed. When you buy a tree at a nursery, it'll have a stake right along the side of it. That stake should always be removed when you plant the tree. Take it away and put two stakes on opposite sides, and then use a flexible material like this. And that allows it to move, and then because staking can result in staking injuries. And if you leave that nursery stake up against the trunk and it's tied on tightly with that green planting, it can stretch the trunk right there. And that becomes a permanent weakness in the trunk. And I've seen a whole row of trees where they left the nursery stakes on and they left that green plant tape on or tying tape. And then the wind came up one day and snapped all off wherever that plant tape was. And you take that plant tape off and you see it is constricted. You can come back years later and you'll still see that constricted tone right on that line table. So remove the nervous tank and put two on opposite sides and get away from them. Now let's take a look at our next different succession. Again, this is about staking. And again, you can see that they've used these two stakes on opposite sides. No, it really isn't necessary to use this one. That one really isn't doing a lot of good, and it doesn't hurt pretty much. Now, it's important to remove this in about 12 to 18 to 24 months. And so this is proper staking. The other thing that they put here is the trunk guard at the very base of the tree. This is also very important for certain trees or trees planted in parkway or a lawn. One of the biggest problems for trees is people come with a weed whacker and whack around here. And they do that every week. And that plastic string will strip the bark off the base of the tree and girdle the tree. And they do it week after week after week. And sometimes you'll come back, you'll come to the tree that's under stress and declining and not doing well. And you look down and you'll see that this base right here has been constricted. It's been whacked off with a weed whacker. So you don't want to, first of all, stay away from the weed whacker. What you really should do is clear this lawn out all around here, pull it out and bare soil around the base of this tree. That would be the best thing for the tree. This plastic guard will protect it in case someone gets it with a lawnmower or and protect it from the weed whacker. But it is actually much better to have no grass right around the base of the tree. So I often see, the smaller street trees that things like a crepe myrtle, and they're doing badly. And you look down, and that base of the trunk has just been stripped away by a weed whacker. Let's take a look at our next photo in succession. And here is a rather ridiculous situation. Here you've got, it was originally staked properly with these two stakes, probably 10 years, 20 years even prior to this photograph being taken. And here's this flexible material that they use to tie it to. Obviously, these two little stakes are not holding up this tree. This tree is holding up the stakes. But you can see that this cane has cut into the trunk. And this now becomes a permanent wound or a permanent weak point in the trunk. A very strong wind, and it can break right there. And I've seen it break right there. So, stake for 1 year in general, up to 2 years depending on the growth of the tree, and whether if you take the stakes down and the tree starts to bend over, then you're going to need to leave them up. Now, generally speaking, you don't need to stake trees that hold themselves up, but unfortunately, in nursery production, they have that nursery stake. The plants are all pushed together in a small area, and when you take your 5 gallon or 15 gallon, and you put it in the ground, and you take away that stake, the tree doesn't bend over because it was depending on that stake to stand up straight. So where do you actually tie it? Usually right around breast height is where you put the flexible material. But if you can hold it low and hold it and hold it, and if you hold it here and it still bends over, then you hold it up and until it holds up straight, and that's where you put the flexible material. But again, take them off after about a year or two. Let's take a look at our next photograph. Okay, this is about narrow crotches. And if we'll bring this up full screen, there are a couple of things. This is a U-shaped crotch, and that's considered a strong union. These two branches are well connected to each other. This is a narrow crotch, and these two branches are not connected to each other. Either one of these can just live and fall away in high wind, or sometimes no wind at all. This of course looks like a very young tree. But if you come back in 20 years and these are not this big and this big, and the crotch is actually like this, then it's very likely that one of these will rip and fall away. And the other thing you can see in this diagram is right in here. This is called the included bark, where the bark of the two branches is what touches right here. So how you avoid this? You avoid this by pruning the tree when you plant it. Now, often the trees have been topped or, you know, this just tent in nursery country. That tends to make the bush, the tree look bushier. It looks a little better in the nursery. That's not the best thing for the tree. And when you nip the top of the tree, it's going to break and have several new shoots coming out. And that's what's happened on these pictures. So what you want to do is pick one of those shoots to be your central leader, and the other two eventually are going to remove. But again, they are producing food for the tree, so you want to retain them for some period of time, usually about a year or 2 years. And you want to dwarf them, so you're going to tip them just like you tip the side branches on the trunk to dwarf them, but retain them for their growth, for their production of food for the tree. So when you plant that tree, you tip, you just cut the tips off the side branches, and you use the lawn, you cut the tips off. You pick a simple leader. If you have multiple leaders, if you have co-dominant leaders, is the correct term. Either two or three, all rising at the same point. You pick one that you want to keep, usually the straightest one or the tallest one, but it's a very art of pruning. You have a decision which one is the best one to keep. It's kind of an aesthetic decision as well. And typically when I'm doing this, I pick the tallest one or I pick the straightest one. The others I will cut off about 3 inches off the tip, maybe even up to 6 inches, depending on the species and the actual situation I'm faced with. Then I'll come back in about 12 months and I'll remove them completely from the tree. So it has one central leader. You want your tree to have one leader, and then you want your branches to come off, and you want them to be distributed horizontally and vertically. Horizontally this way and vertically this way. You don't want branches overlapping, and you want to avoid that type of situation. When the tree's young, you can do it with just a pair of hand shears. If you've made 10 or 20 years, and you've got multiple branches attached at the same point, we call that bowl branching. You have to prune that with a chainsaw, or actually, you really can't do anything about it, because typically, if you remove one of those large scaffolds, you're going to remove about a third of the canopy on one side, and then you end up with an ace back of the tree. Now, let's see if we've got any other pictures to fill up today. That's probably the only thing we've got today. Oh, here's a good picture. Let's bring this up. This is exactly what I'm talking about. This is called bowl branching. Here we see multiple branch attachment at the same point. This is a silver maple. They tend to have a lot of decay in silver maples. Here's a very large scaffold that was removed or fell off at some point. Not unusual is that the callus formation, which is right there, has not sealed off this wound, and you've got a decay pocket right there. So if you have heart rot, guaranteed in this tree, all these scaffolds now are all attached right here. They're not attached to each other, and they tend to rip and tear up. Well, our time has run out. Thank you for tuning in to 8 Hours in California. Please tune in again next week. And I'd like to thank all our staff for their hard work and putting on the show. Thank you for tuning in. I'm sorry.